2. It's a fairly well-known verse, but it's also a good summary of what it means to grow and mature as Christians. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Paul wrote this to the church in Rome, but it's a general statement exhorting all Christians to seek this ongoing transformation in our lives. Notice that Paul does not say to make a little change here and just a little tweak over there. He wants a major transformation brought about by an interchange of how we think. This is a transformation that we work at throughout our lives. Weak Christians become strong Christians, and strong Christians become stronger Christians. It may be a subconscious reduction, but we sometimes reduce our perception of this transformation to a few obvious differences between Christian conduct and worldly conduct. We might think that if we are basically honest, sexually pure, that's always important, and that we control our tongues and, of course, go to church, that we have this transformation under control. And there is no doubt that if we have done those areas, covered those things, we have made probably great progress. And there's no doubt that these few areas represent a large portion of our major problem areas and challenges. But there may be still more to it than that. The letters of the New Testament were written to churches and to Christians. In some cases, they were written to correct specific problems of behavior or doctrinal things. But much of the content of the letters is focused on this broad area of overall transformation. Transformation language, transformation thoughts are much more frequent in the New Testament letters than we sometimes realize. These letters were written to help Christians of all levels of spiritual development understand the truly unique nature of being Christians and of being the church. To illustrate this, let's take a look at our default example of underdeveloped Christians. The first century church in Corinth has a 2,000-year-old reputation for spiritual underdevelopment. And we know that they had a lot of internal problems. Some of those problems were doctrinal issues, but for the most part, their problems were behavior issues. In short, they were Christians. But as individuals and as a congregation, they didn't act like Christians and they didn't think like Christians. A good summary of their condition is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 1, where Paul wrote, "And I, brethren, could not speak to you as to spiritual people, but as to carnal, as to babes in Christ." He doesn't deny that they are Christians. In fact, he calls them brethren, babes in Christ. And that was the problem. It's no revelation that people of the world are worldly and live and do worldly things. The problem here was that these were Christians who had not made the transformation from worldly to spiritual. And to a great extent, it sounds like that they didn't even realize that there was a transformation to be made. In their minds, they were the same people they had always been, except now they did Christian rituals instead of pagan rituals. Pagan groups did pagan things, trade guilds did professional things, sports groups did sports things, and a Christian group did Christian things, like the Lord's Supper, which the Corinthian Christians observed every week, still, in spite of all their problems. All of these letters, whether it be Romans or Corinthians or any of the others, were written to help Christians realize that the uniqueness of the church was not limited to the main corporate activities of the group. Being Christians, being followers of Christ, being a congregation of His people was more and was more fundamental than just changing the meeting agenda from pagan or secular to Christian things. In the Corinthian case, there were major problems to correct. But in many of the other letters, that wasn't the case. In many cases, the first readers of these letters were doing well spiritually, and the letters were written to guide and encourage them to continue in their pursuit of that spiritual transformation. For the moment, in this series of lessons on His Church as My Church, we are looking at the church in Ephesus. From what we can tell, the church in Ephesus was a good church. We have essentially four snapshots of conditions in the Ephesian church taken over a period of maybe 40 years. The first glimpse we have is in Acts chapters 19 and 20, which is the story of the founding of the Ephesian church and Paul's 2 years of work right there with them. He started by preaching to Jews and converting some Jews, and then shifted his audience to a more Gentile audience. Eventually, they faced major opposition from pagan merchants, and this resulted in Paul needing to leave town. The violent action against Paul, and possibly the after effects for the Christians who remained in Ephesus, possibly drew those young Christians closer to each other than they had ever been. Persecution tends to do that. A few months later, Paul had a brief meeting with the elders of the Ephesian church, and in that meeting he warned them of the spiritual and doctrinal problems that they would face in the future. The second snapshot that we have is what we have here in Paul's letter to the Ephesians. We'll come back to that in more detail in a moment. For now, we'll just note that Paul was thankful for their faith and for their love for all the saints. They were in relatively good spiritual shape. The third snapshot is when Paul wrote two letters to Timothy, when Timothy was serving as the local evangelist in the church in Ephesus. This was about 10 years after the congregation had been founded. And at this time, there were a few problems creeping up. Maybe not crisis situations yet, but there were things happening. For example, Paul gave Timothy instructions about appointing qualified elders, which suggests that possibly something had happened with those elders that he had met with earlier in Acts chapter 20. And then the fourth snapshot of the Ephesian church is what we read in Revelation chapter 2. This was probably several years later, but maybe not. But whenever Revelation was written, the Ephesian church was holding firm against certain sinful behaviors and false doctrines, but the love that they had been known for previously had weakened. My point in all of this is that the Ephesian church seems to have had pretty much the normal ups and downs of many congregations, but overall, it was a decent, healthy congregation. So what really was Paul trying to accomplish when he wrote his letter to the church in Ephesus? Obviously, he does not say, "Everything is perfect, therefore I have nothing to say." As a congregation, they were not perfect. As individual Christians, they had no perfect members. But at the same time, I don't find anything in the letter that would be classified as a strong rebuke, sort of the style of 1 Corinthians. Yes, he wants them to move forward. He wants them to continue to grow in faith and in unity. But there are no glaring moral or doctrinal issues that needed to be corrected absolutely right now. It's more a matter of helping them understand the depths of the differences between life in the church and life in any other group. The church was the assembly of the saved. No other group could say that. But when God brought the saved together to form the church, He expected the internal relationships in the church to be different from the relationships in any other group or in any other setting. That was because the church and every member in the church had a divine calling that was unique. Today we might say that the calling of the church is proprietary. It is exclusive to this group. So Paul spent the first half of his letter explaining the unique calling of the church and identifying the many blessings that God had given them to equip them so that they could grow in response to that calling. So in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17, he brings the idea of the transformation to the front of the discussion. As I've already said, the first three chapters describe God's concept for the church. In the first part of chapter 4, he's still describing what God has done so that the church can fulfill its calling. And as we read the early part of chapter 4, we can see the response that a response is going to be needed or expected from the readers of the letter. It's becoming clear that Christians are going to have to do certain things. But so far, he hasn't given them any specific instructions about what to do. That changes in chapter 4, verse 17. "This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk, in the futility of their mind." We are now in the topic of transformation. You should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk. This isn't nearly as strong as what he said to the Corinthians about being carnal and not spiritual. He's not saying that the Ephesian Christians were still living fully as Gentiles and they needed to stop that immediately. This is more the idea of their need to continue living less and less as Gentiles and more as people who belong to Christ. To do that, they would need to put off the former conduct of the old man and be renewed in the spirit of their mind. They would need to put on this new man, verse 24, "and that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness." Technically and doctrinally, when they were baptized, the old man died and the new man was born at that time. Excuse me. But here, Paul is talking about the practical application of that change. The practical application was the daily effort, the ongoing process of living holy and righteous lives. So for 3 3/4 chapters, Paul has been building a foundation. He has presented a concept. He has presented God's intentions. He has affirmed God's efforts to equip them to do the job. And now he starts identifying specific things to do. Beginning in chapter 4, verse 25, Paul reveals what life in the body of Christ is supposed to look like and what Christians are supposed to do. The first thing he says is to quit lying to each other and tell the truth. That's verse 25. "Therefore, putting away lying, let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another." It could be that lying was a major problem in the Ephesian church. But personally, I don't see that. That doesn't seem to be the tone of the letter. All of the growth areas in these verses are areas where in most churches today, most Christians do a good job most of the time. And my opinion is that it was pretty much the same in the Ephesian church. They were not a bunch of habitual, intentional liars. But there was a level of truth-telling yet to be achieved and appreciated in the unique context of the fellowship of Christians. First, let's look again at that context. The lying, the anger, the stealing, all of the sins and corrective behaviors in the following verses should be practiced by Christians all of the time. We shouldn't lie to non-Christians any more than we lie to anyone else or to each other. But that is a simple moral obligation. But Paul doesn't tell us to speak the truth because lying is a moral sin. Even though that would have been a true thing to say, that's not what he says. He says, speak the truth to your neighbor, for we are members of one another. Neighbor, in this case, I believe, is synonymous with our brothers and sisters in Christ. So this is about more than just not committing the sin of lying. This is about building and maintaining relationships in the body of Christ. Christians should not lie, especially to one another, because lying undermines the relationship. And the relationship between Christians is special because it's built on the blood of Christ. A few verses earlier, and we talked about this last week, Paul had said to tell the truth in love. Think about the dynamics of telling the truth in love. Not just the fact that we're supposed to do it, but the dynamics of actually doing it. The illustration that I'm going to use now is purely fictitious, not based on any real incident. Keep that in mind. It never really happens. But if it should ever be true that my wife's dress makes her look fat, and I am a truth teller, should I tell her? The answer to that question involves more than just to tell the truth or to tell a lie. My appreciation of the relationship is involved here. If I am loving and smart, I will give careful thought to what I say and how I say it. Because one, I am committed to being truthful. I am committed to the relationship and committed to exercising love in everything that I do and say, and because I cherish the relationship. Now apply that same pair of commitments to both love and truth to how we express truth to each other in the church, and you will see the power of transformed lives in the context of the church. You will also see the uniqueness of the church. If we tell the truth, but we tell the truth only after we have seriously and sometimes painfully considered the most loving way to say it or not say it at all, we will truly have churches that are unlike any other group of people. Not simply because people tell the truth, but because they are deeply concerned about how telling the truth will impact the other members and maintain the relationships. Paul's second transformational behavior is about anger, verses 26 and 7. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. Is this statement to be taken literally, or is it more of an idiomatic expression? Let me explain the question. Is he saying that it's okay to be angry as long as we don't sin, in which case, human nature being what it is, we will start examining the different things that make us angry and we'll try to identify which ones justify our outburst of anger and which ones don't. And this is when we will bring righteous indignation and Jesus chasing the money changers out of the temple into the conversation. Or is he talking about a transformed life where we may or may not get angry, but we don't allow anger to control us ever? We don't allow it to poison our relationships. We don't allow it to harm the church. In general, none of the sins listed in this passage is a major problem for most Christians. On a good day, when things go our way, lying and anger and stealing or the rest of these are not major issues for most Christians. But when we get riled up, even with righteous indignation, then we sometimes give ourselves permission to say mean things, even if they might harm the body of Christ. I don't know how many convicted thieves there were in the Ephesian church, but he mentions them in verse 28. Let him who stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give to him who is in need. The sin of stealing could also have the broader meaning of taking anything that we didn't rightfully earn or taking it under false pretenses. But the verse also shows the need to replace wrong behavior with right behavior. Christians are people who don't do wrong things, but they are also to be people who do good things and help others. Several of the sins that Paul mentions in this passage involve things we say. We've already covered the lying. Anger is often connected with things that are said in anger. But in verse 29, he gives a somewhat general term, corrupt communication or corrupt words. Verse 29, let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. Other translations have corrupting talk or unwholesome talk. Is he talking about swear words or obscenities or gossip or slander? And the answer is probably yes to all of the above. It doesn't matter if it's the words themselves or the thoughts expressed by them. Corrupt communication is communication that defiles both the speaker and the hearer. The communication of a Christian, he says, should build up. Now, that doesn't mean that everything has to be theologically informative. Casual conversation and pleasantries are all right. But our conversations should bring goodness and grace to the people around us. Christians are called to be builders, not destroyers. We're called to bring blessings, not defilement, especially within the body. And then at first glance, verse 30 doesn't seem to fit into the flow of what he is saying. He has been identifying specific sins to avoid, and then we get to this somewhat general statement in verse 30. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. But it does fit. It fits because it keeps these practical exhortations tied to the overall message and context. Back in verse 3, he said the Holy Spirit works to bring unity and peace to the body of Christ. Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, there is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling. Any of the sins in verses 25 and following will work contrary to what the Spirit is trying to accomplish. If the Spirit is working for unity in the church and for peace in the church, and our behavior divides the church, that will grieve the Holy Spirit of God. We should live in a way that is consistent with the goals of God, no exceptions, no excuses. And then the chapter closes in verse 32 with a reminder about the environment that we are to maintain. Be kind, tender-hearted, and forgiving. That's very similar to what we looked at last week in verse 2 about lowly, gentle, patient, and bearing with one another. And all of these are direct opposites of the items in verse 31, bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking. They cannot coexist. One group of these things builds healthy, nurturing bodies of Christians, and the other destroys them. So I'll close by repeating something that I said earlier. Overall, all of the virtues to cultivate and the sins to avoid in verses 25 through 32 should describe a Christian's behavior in all situations and with all kinds of people, not just among Christians. Christian virtue is needed in this world. The light of our gracious conduct will often outshine the light of our biblical doctrines. But we miss the message of Ephesians if we don't see these virtues, first of all, as necessary characteristics in the church. God wants us to be together with healthy relationships between us. We need to be together with healthy relationships between us. And for the church to have a saving influence on the world, we must have healthy relationships between us. We are not the church God has called us to be any other way. Christ died to save people from their sins and to bring saved sinners into healthy relationships both with Himself and with each other. Church involvement isn't an optional feature of being a Christian. It is a fundamental part of what it means to be a Christian. Christ is the head, the members of the body, and we are all organically connected to each other. If you are not in Christ, you are not in His church, and your sins have not been forgiven, but that can be changed. Confess your faith in Christ as God's Son. Make a commitment to turning away from sin as a way of life, and be immersed for the forgiveness of your sins. God will forgive you. He will add you to His church, and you will have a church family to help you and to encourage you to live your life in the way that is worthy of the calling we have received from God. If you want to respond this morning, let us know while we stand and while we sing.